Yes, when I practiced psychiatry in the British Army, I was a psychiatrist in the British Army, you know, at the time of Korea, for 2 years, as I was called up and I practiced as a psychiatrist. I was on the one hand an officer in the British Army, and on the other hand I was a doctor whose first duty was to my patients. Well, in actual fact, I'll say this for the British Army, that they didn't make it too difficult for me. You know, they were actually quite glad for these people to be treated as patients. But, for instance, the British Army, like any other organisation, has the problem of what to do with people who claim compensation for disability accrued as a result of military service. So the British Army was very interested, for economic reasons, what medical diagnosis would be placed on people. If it was one diagnosis, they would get a pension for life. If it was another diagnosis, they wouldn't. And I would get a directive saying that I was diagnosing too many people this way or that way, and the diagnosis would be affected by these economic, political, military considerations. And there have been other studies in civilian life in America, etc., etc., showing that the same sort of people are diagnosed this way or that way according to whether they go to a state hospital or they go to a private psychiatrist, and that's computerized and in their dossier. If you've got enough money to go to a private psychiatrist, you've got a better chance of being called neurotic than if you go to a state hospital, where you're more likely to be called psychotic for the same sort of distress.
Do you think you'll be shuddering? I mean, I feel I'll be shuddering when I look back at this time and the way we treat mentally unhealthy people, if that's the right way to describe it. I mean, because, I mean, for instance, the electric shock treatment. Will we be thinking how awful we've been?
Well, I hope so. Let me try and put my own perspective on this. I don't think it's only psychiatry. It's what happens to anyone in our society in the course of one's whole life cycle. You know, whether one's a baby being born, or a mother in childbirth, or whether one's an old person who is too frail to take care of himself. It's what happens. It's the quality of care that is going to happen when one is unable to take care of oneself and is at the mercy of other human beings. Now, I don't think that the whole of psychiatry is a dead loss by any means. For instance, my father is an old, frail man who's lost his memory. He's lost his memory about 10 years ago completely. And my mother's a frail old lady, and she can't take care of him. And he's been in the psychotic geriatric ward of a mental hospital in Glasgow now for the last 10 years. Now, the people there have taken care of him and all the other people like him in an exemplary manner. He's treated with courtesy and respect. He's not degraded or subject to humiliation. He's treated, I think, with genuine care and warmth. Now, that can be said of a lot of places, and that's marvelous. That is absolutely marvelous. At the same time, there are a lot of places where that doesn't happen. That's one thing. And then the way women are treated in childbirth in many places now, and babies are treated in childbirth, makes me cringe. I mean, it makes, when I saw babies being born in many contexts in hospital, not everywhere, not always, you know, but enough places, to make me feel it was very risky to, I mean, if I could choose where I was going to be born, I would be very careful about it, because it's the luck of the draw. Sometimes it's very pleasant, but sometimes it's very brutal.
You've changed to writing tracts, poems, statements.
Tracts. Is that to make it? I don't know whether tracts.
Well, no. Statements.
Statements.
Is that because you feel that you've got something to say that's much clearer this way than any other way?
No, I don't. Not able to justify it. It's just the way it comes out. A few years ago, sort of things that appear in knots and have now appeared in this last book. It started occurring to
right.
me.
Well, I'm going to want to read a bit of your book. Is that all right? Between us, we'll do a dialogue.
All right.
Do You Love Me, which is coming out in paperback, isn't it? Shall we start?
All right.
Do you love me?
Yes, I love you.
Best of all?
Best of all.
More than the whole world?
More than the whole world.
Do you like me?
Yes, I like you.
Do you like being near me?
Yes, I like being near you.
Do you like to look at me?
Yes, I like to look at you.
Do you think I'm stupid?
No, I don't think you're stupid.
Do you think I'm attractive?
Yes, I think you're attractive.
But do I bore you?
No, you don't bore me.
Do you like my eyebrows?
Yes, I like your eyebrows.
Very much?
Very much.
Which one do you like the most?
If I say one, the other will be jealous.
But you have to say.
They are both exquisite.
Honest?
Honest.
Have I got nice eyelashes?
Nice eyelashes.
Do you like to smell me?
Yes, I like to smell you.
Do you like my perfume?
Yes, I like your perfume.
Do you think I've got good taste?
Yes, I think you've got good taste.
Do you think I'm talented?
Yes, I think you're talented.
You don't think I'm lazy?
No, I don't think you're lazy.
Do you like to touch me?
Yes, I like to touch you.
Do you think I'm funny?
Only in a nice way.
Are you laughing at
me? No, I'm not laughing at you.
Do you really love me?
Yes, I really love you.
Say, I love you.
I love you.
Do you want to hug me?
I want to hug you and cuddle you and bill and coo with you.
Is it all right?
It's all right.
Swear you'll never leave me.
I swear I'll never, ever leave you, cross my heart and hope to die if I tell a lie.
Do you really love me? Now, what I really want to ask you is, how did you know I talk like that? May I say thank you very much for talking to me today. I have enjoyed it.
Really?
Honestly?
Honest?
Honest. Oh. Have you really liked talking to me?
Yes, I really.
Really?